Let's continue working on our person class. And in the previous videos, you have seen how we have been able to create a class representing what properties a person has, name, year of birth, height, etc. We have been able to define different ways of creating objects with different constructors. So creating a person object only from the name, or being more explicit about other data that belongs to that person, right? And we have seen how variables inside of objects represent these properties, all right? Another thing that we may want to add to objects is functionality, right? People can have names, year of birth, etc., but they can also do things. They can say hi, they can die, they can grow up, they can do many different things, all right? Just like in order to represent properties of an object, we used variables that live inside of those objects, then to create functionality for those objects, we're going to be creating functions that live inside of that class. All right, so it's the same principle. So I'm going to scroll all the way down here, and I'm going to say I'm going to create here a set of methods. Methods is typically the name that is given to functions that live inside of a class, all right, or inside of an object. And methods are basically going to be functions that can be called for this particular object. So, for example, if this is people, something that I may want to do is I may want to create a function that is called say hi, all right? And then I'm going to open and close parentheses, open and close curly brackets, and this function is going to return nothing. So it's going to be a void function, because the only thing that it's going to do is it's going to print to the console a message that is saying hi, all right? If you don't remember how to create functions, you can check my previous video. But what I've done here is basically create a function that lives inside of this object. And remember that if I want external code to be able to use this function, I need to add the public accessor. This is a very C# specific thing, all right? So great. So now, because I have created a function inside of my person class, that means that any object that I create from my person class, for example, Jose Luis, will have a new thing that it can do. So for example, JL dot, and you can see that now we have this new thing here in the autocomplete list, which is whether if the person can say hi or not. So I'm going to double click here, I'm going to open and close parentheses. And if I run this code, let's see if I get anything on the console. You can see that I do get this string message here called, hey, hi, how are you doing, right? Okay, so this is great, but I think the fact that it only says hi, it's a little dull, it's a little empty. And because if all the objects just say hi, then why are we bothering giving them personal, in particular information and different properties, right? So maybe we could improve this method by adding some information so that when the object says hi, it also says like, hey, hi, I'm Jose, or I'm Jane, or I'm whatever. And therefore, using some of their own internal information to customize that message, all right? So something that I can do is I can say, well, I'm going to modify this method. I'm going to say, instead of just saying hi, I'm going to say, hi, I am, and then I'm going to stick to this message. I'm going to stick the particular name that this object has. So I can do this dot name to refer to the name value that is stored in this particular object that we're running the code from, or you could also save yourself this and then just write name plainly. Okay, I like the this dot just because this is an educational video. All right, so let me run this code now. So if I run this code, you can see that it says, hi, I am Jose, right? And if I were to run this code from a different object, where is Jane? I got rid of Jane. Oh, sorry, Jane. So let me create another Jane object. So person, Jane equals a new person, and that's going to be Jane. She was born in 2000 and she's 5.8. All right. So JLL says hi, and Jen can also say hi. And if I run this code, you can see, hi, I'm Jose. Hi, I'm Jane. And let's give it a bit more expressivity here. I'm just going to write here. There you go. All right. So that's great. So you can see how the sayHi method is now using information that lives inside of the class, which is really nice because now the behavior of each one of the objects depends on their data, depends on of like internal information that they contain. And that's actually the power of why object-oriented programming is so interesting and so cool, right? So for example, let's say that this is going to be a little grim, okay? But we know that when we create objects, we can say that whether if they're alive or dead, right? So something that we can do is when we create methods, we can not only use those methods to read information that belongs to the object, but also we can use those methods to change information from that object. Okay, so for example, if I were to create a public void function called die, and this is a little sad, right? But whatever. What I can use this method for is I could say this dot is alive, is not whatever it was before, is going to be false now. Okay, so what I can use that for is, let's say I'm going to kill, let me kill Jose Luis. So Jose Luis, let's print, first of all, let's print cons, oh God, console.writeline.jl.isAlive, right? And then I'm going to kill him, boom. And then I'm going to print the same thing over again. All right, so I'm going to say, yes, where is my window? Okay, so I'm going to say, yeah, Jose Luis, when it was created, Jose Luis was alive, but then Jose Luis was killed, or, and then afterwards, the value of whether if he is alive or not is not true anymore. All right, does that make sense? So methods can be used to read information from the object, but it can also be used to change information from the object. They can also be used to calculate information from the object. So remember in the video when I said before, we're going to change from defining people by their age, we're going to change to defining them by their year of birth, all right? Because this is more interesting, if we were to store these things in a database, we want year of birth because then we can calculate their age on any year after we run this program, right? So, but right now, there's no way for us to get the age, right? So we can actually calculate the age, for example, by saying, I'm going to create a public function that is going to return an integer, that age, and I'm going to call this, for example, get age. All right, and I'm going to do that by saying, well, how do I calculate the age? Well, the age has to be whatever year we are on right now minus the year of birth. So what I can say is I'm going to return the year that we are right now, so date time dot now dot year minus this year of birth, the year of birth for this particular object. Okay, so Jose Luis, say hi. So we're going to print here console write line. So for example, let jlh, that's going to be equal to jl.get the age of this object, and let's print that to the console, jlh. And it turns out that Jose Luis is 70 years old right now, okay, because he was born in 1950. Okay, so methods are also very, 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 very common to perform calculations that relate to the particular object. In this case, I'm using the information that lives here to perform some calculations. And this code, I like it a little better now when it comes to representing people, because by storing the year of birth, that's going to be immutable. That's never going to change. But the age may change depending on when we are running this program, right? So I think the person class is a bit better now. I like it better conceptually by design, right? The lesson that I want to talk about is I want to make the greeting part even a little better, because I want to show you the fact that we can actually, that the methods that we have created so far, were simple functions that didn't take any information and they return nothing, or they return a number, right? But I want to show you how methods can also take information. They can take arguments just like any other function, and we can use that to work and make them smarter. So for example, the say hi function was a little dry because like this person was saying, hi, I am Jose, but it wasn't really greeting anyone. So I'm going to actually change this to the word greet. Okay. And I'm going to create some overloads where I'm actually going to implement a version of the greet method that actually says hi to someone. All right. So for example, I'm going to say public void greet, and then I'm going to create an overload because it's going to have the same name, but it's going to have a different types and different amounts of inputs. So I'm going to say, well, other, I'm going, this function, this method is going to accept the name of another person. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to create, I'm going to print, hi, other person, other name, right? And I'm going to close the curlies, and then I'm going to say, I am my name. So the message here is going to be, hi, whoever, I am my own name. All right. So now, for example, here, I'm going to delete this stuff here. Now, I don't have say hi anymore. I have greet. So remember, if I call greet just on its own, what I'm going to get is, So what I'm going to say is like, I only get, hey, I am Jose. But if I call this method by saying, greet, I want to greet Jane here, right? So I'm going to pass in the name Jane. And then you can see how now the other overload is called, and this thing has, hi Jane, I am Jose. All right. So that's great. Okay. But wait, so I want to greet Jane, and but it turns out that Jane is already something that is living here in my code, right? So maybe what I can do is I can say, well, maybe instead of passing the string Jane, because what if I change the name here and Jane is now Janine or Jennifer or whatever, right? So I would have to manually change this here. So I can make this a bit more programmatic by saying, I always want to greet whoever is Jane, whatever her name is at any given point, so that if this name ever changes for whatever reason, my code still greets the same person. Okay, so I can say, I want to greet Jane.name, because since this method takes a string, the name property is a string inside of Jane. So you can see like, hi Jane, I am Jose. Okay. But wait for it. Wait for it. Because if I'm always going to be greeting a person, and I know that person objects always have names, because that's what I have defined as part of how the person class works. All right. Then maybe having to explicitly say that I need to greet the name Jane as opposed to the person Jane is a little redundant. So maybe I want to be able to write cleaner code that says, I want to be able to greet without any name. I want to be able to greet Jane as a name, as a string, but I may also want to be able to greet Jane as an object directly. So given a Jane object, I may want to be able to greet her directly without having to read the name property of her. So how does that work? How can I do that? Well, it turns out that because I have now created a person class that has all these properties and all this functionality, and we discussed before how when I do that, then person as a thing also becomes a new type of variable that I can use for JL, for Jane, etc. But it basically becomes a new type. Then I can use that type as data types that I can use in other methods, in other functionalities, in other algorithms, etc. So for example, in my overloads, I can say, I may want to have a function that greets whoever without a name. I may want to have a function that greets a particular string name that I have been given. But I may want to have a function that says, I want to be able to greet some person object that you're giving me. You know? And if the input of this function is of the type person, then I know that what I can do is, because I know that person objects always have a name property, I can say, I'm going to greet from the other person, I'm going to greet that person using their name property. Oh, what? And if I do this, you can see how, hi Jane, I am Jose. This is the third one, all right? Let me clear this up so that it's not so confusing, all right? And you can see how now I'm greeting Jane, and I know that person objects always have a name property. So that's why this function can now work by taking person objects and then from their person objects reading their name property. All right? What? All right. So the fact that I'm using a person class here is independent from the fact that I am inside of the person class. All right? The idea is that now person as a data type can be used anywhere in my program, anywhere that there is access to the person class. All right. So how was that? This is the beauty of object-oriented programming. Now that we have person classes, or that you have any custom class, you can use that as data type and exchange that data type with other methods, other algorithms, and work more smartly with your data. All right. Let's move on to the next video, where I'm going to explain one very important and particular method that all objects have, and that is very convenient for us to work with.